By faith, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. O my God, I firmly believe that you are one God, three divine persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I believe that your divine Son became man and died for our sins, and that he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe these and all the truths the Holy Catholic Church teaches, because you have revealed them. Who can neither deceive nor be deceived. Amen. August Queen of Heaven, Sovereign Mistress of the Angels, who did receive from the beginning the mission and the power to crush the serpent's head, we beseech thee to send thy holy angels, that under thy command and by thy power they may pursue the evil spirits, encounter them on every side, resist their bold attacks, and drive them hence into the abyss of woe. Most Holy Mother, send thy holy angels to defend us and to drive the cruel enemy from us. O good and tender Mother, thou shalt ever be our love and our hope. Holy angels and archangels, keep and defend us. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit, by means of the powerful intercession of the Immaculate Heart of Mary, your well-beloved spouse, enlighten us, guide us, and increase in us all the virtues necessary to live a life totally devoted to Jesus through Mary. Instill in our hearts a filial love and dependence on the Mother of God. Give us great confidence in her maternal heart and abiding refuge in her mercy, so that by her you may truly form in us Jesus Christ, great and mighty, unto the fullness of his perfect age. Amen. Mother of Good Counsel,
pray for us.
Our Lady of Fatima,
pray for us.
Our Lady of Guadalupe, patroness of the unborn,
pray for us.
Saints Joachim and Anne,
pray for us.
Saint Joseph, patron of the Universal Church,
pray for us.
Saint Louis de Montfort,
pray for us.
Saint Maximian Kolbe,
pray for us.
Blessed Teresa of Calcutta,
pray for us.
Blessed John Paul the Great,
pray for us.
Our patron saints and guardian angels,
pray for us.
Amen. I just want to mention before I forget that some people brought in some pro-life materials here, so please come help yourself. They're right in the middle of the table here. One of them is to spiritually adopt an unborn child. Maybe you've heard of that before. It's been around. I think it was, I can't remember, Bishop Sheen, I think, came up with that idea to spiritually adopt. And you pray for a baby for 9 months, and you can name that child that you will never meet until heaven. But it's a beautiful devotion, and then there's some other information up here. So, also, thank you for those who have donated toward our babysitting fund. We have more sitters than we have enough people with kids to pay the sitters, so I'm just asking if you can make a small donation. With this many people, a small donation is all it's going to take to cover that for the year. So thank you. And then, of course, there's name tags. I can't see them all, but I'd like to get to know everyone's name, and it takes me sometimes several years. okay, today, it's just so awesome that it's the Feast of the Name of Mary, and I mentioned last time that this book is True Devotion to Mary, but the Montfort Fathers renamed it True Devotion to the Blessed Virgin in 1950, and so that's another book. It's the same book, but it's modern language, and it's actually kind of nice to have as a backup. I mean, if you're something you don't understand, you can get that version, and it uses everyday language, and so it is nice to have. I prefer this older language, even though it's more difficult, because it's the exact translation from the French, and I just love it. So, but anyway, it concerned me that they changed the name, and I thought, oh, maybe we shouldn't call her Mary. Maybe maybe it's not reverent. And then I woke up, and it was the Feast of the Name of Mary. Holy, that we have a feast, and she's included in the divine praises. I thought of that this morning. Blessed be the name of Mary, Virgin and Mother. So her name is holy, but I just barely had time to read my Magnificat, but I'm just going to, of course, I shouldn't be surprised, but it mentions St. Louis de Montfort twice. So I'm going to read that to you if you want to open your Magnificat, if you have it. Okay, this is at the beginning of the Mass. I'll just read a little bit here. It says, our salvation begins when an archangel speaks the name of Mary. To be Christian is to carry on that annunciation unceasingly. St. Louis de Montfort wrote that the salvation of each individual is bound up with the Hail Mary. This prayer that names the holy name of the Mother of God brought to a dry and barren world the fruit of life. It will cause the Word of God to take root in the soul and bring forth Jesus. The holy name of Mary bears such power because of the unique bond between mother and son. When God sent his son, born of a woman, he instituted a once and for all order of salvation in which the union of mother and child stands at the center. To accept the divine privilege of speaking the name of Mary is to participate in that saving union. Oh, so beautiful. And we talked about that last time, about the union of Jesus and Mary, and that you should try to think about them together all the time, and that will help you with this devotion. And then in the meditation of the day actually says some of the same thing here. I'll just read it. The true greatness of the holy name of Mary is its instrumentality in our salvation. Just as the salvation of the world began with the Hail Mary, explained St. Louis de Montfort, so the salvation of each individual is bound up with it. Okay, now we read that part. The Hail Mary is the heavenly, I love this, this is in our book later in the year. The Hail Mary is the heavenly dew which waters the earth of our soul and makes it bear fruit in due season. It was just so beautiful. So in due season, so it might not be you experience the effects today, but, you know, we pray for us now and at the hour of our death, you know, you pray that you're millions of times in your life, she's going to be there. And then just a little bit more here. It says, when we say the name of Mary in faith, we receive the unsurpassable gift of being loved by God. Blessed Henry Suso exults, and I have to agree with him. When I pronounce the name of Mary, I feel myself inflamed with such love and joy that between the tears and happiness with which I pronounce this beautiful name, I feel as though my heart might leave my breast. So beautiful. And then one last sentence here. It says, the holy name of Mary rescues us from the abyss of namelessness. So it's just so beautiful and just such a blessing. And my daughter's middle name is Mary, and mine is too, Marie. And so I'm like, it's your feast. You know, if you have that as part of your name, this is your special day. Okay, so since I'm not going to review too much from last time, but we'll just jump right in. And actually, I don't even think we got as far as we did with the Tuesday group. So I think we need to start with paragraph number one. So let's just turn in our books to paragraph number one, which is called the preliminary remarks. Now, these are really lofty. I mean, he just like goes full force here with Mary, and then he kind of backs up a little next meeting and describes, well, compared to God, she's nothing. So, but he starts out, you know, singing her praises, and some of this is going to sound, I mean, to me, it's all incredibly beautiful, and to most of you, I think you'll think the same, but there are some challenging sentences in here, and as we talked about last time, this book was found to be without error. So if something sounds challenging or strange or weird, then, you know, I just ask you to do what Mary did and ponder it, and then we'll talk about it. So this first paragraph, I'm not sure, I think we talked about the first paragraph, so I'll go kind of quick on this one, but and it also has a question associated with it. And I think there's another set of questions up here. The study questions I will send you right before each meeting. Because I continue to work on those. Anyway, the first paragraph is and I'm going to tell you to write in your book, to circle this, underline that, and I really encourage you to do that so that when you read the book next time, you know, you'll be able to remember. And I mean, it's good to take notes too, but then you have to look at two things. You know, next year you might not have your notes. So, but if you write in your book, you should see my book. You know, it's. And I usually have to throw it away and get another one because there's no space left every couple of years. Although this year I took a highlighter. I can write in red one year and then blue one year. But, yeah. So write in your books, okay? That's just a really great place. And same with your Bible. Father Al Lauer always said, write in your Bible. You feel like you shouldn't because it's like sacred or something. But all right. Paragraph number one. Now, what I want you to write is that this is the theme of the book. This is the This is a foundational sentence, and it's actually a summary of the entire book. Okay, so paragraph one. It was through the Most Holy Virgin Mary that Jesus came into the world, and it is also through her that he has to reign in the world. Now, has to reign is kind of an odd translation, but it just means that he must reign, or this is how he will reign in the world. And so what's that mean? As I said, it's really what the whole book is about. That in order to have Jesus reign as intended, we need Mary. We need to have some amount of a devotion to her. And there's, as we know, a lot of people who have no devotion to Mary, and Jesus still reigns in them. So what does it mean exactly? Well, let's look at question number one. And it says, St. Louis de Montfort states the theme of the book in paragraph one. Notice how he immediately begins by showing us the indissoluble union of Jesus and Mary. So that is a theme that we'll talk about all year as well. He wants us to understand that Jesus is the center, the goal, and the end of this devotion. He reminds us of this so that there is no confusion when he pours out his love for Mary by singing her praises and describing her beauty and grandeur. So how is it that Jesus will reign in the world through his Blessed Mother? Because as I said, we know that there's a lot of people who have no devotion to Mary whatsoever, and they're living a very Christ-like life. So here's what he means. And Father Patrick Gaffney, who is a Montfort missionary, and I'm not sure if he coined this term or not, but it's called the Law of the Incarnation. And it's really quite simple. And I think once you hear this, you'll be like, that makes a lot of sense. And the underlying premise of the Law of the Incarnation is that God does not change the way he does things. And it's in Scripture. We'll look at it later, you know, several times. Father Basil said, you know, the church has always taught that, you know, God typically, the way he does things, and we can look at what he did in the beginning, and it carries on throughout salvation history. So how did Jesus come in the world the first time? Through the incarnation. And so it's called the Law of the Incarnation, and what that is where there is the presence of Mary, the Holy Spirit is compelled to go there. So he overshadows Mary to produce Jesus. And that applies to our souls as well. So if we love Mary, honor Mary, pray to Mary, pray the rosary, pray the Hail Mary, we're opening ourselves up to receive more of the Holy Spirit. Okay, we all, you know, most of us are confirmed, we got our gifts, and obviously most of us are baptized as well. We receive the Holy Spirit. But it's, as someone said, I think I gave this analogy last time about the chocolate milk. Did I say that in this class? Okay. So the gifts sort of, when you pour chocolate syrup in a glass of milk, it sits at the bottom. It needs to be stirred up. So Mary's like the spoon that comes along and stirs up the Spirit so that the gifts of the Spirit then begin to well up in our soul. And so then what happens then is Jesus is formed in us in a more full way. So our hearts begin to change. So we don't just have head knowledge of Jesus and who he was. We actually begin to take on more of the attributes of Jesus. We begin to grow in his virtues. Forgiveness becomes easier for us. Our hearts become more pure. We become more humble. All these things that we struggle, and we become more patient. Well, basically, it's the fruits of the Spirit, right? The fruits of the Spirit are peace, love, joy, patience, self-control. There's more, I forget. But those things just begin to happen through Mary's help and intercession. So, so the answer really to this question is the law of the incarnation brings the fullness of Jesus in our souls. And this is what God intended, and this is what Jesus intended when he gave us his mother from the cross. Okay? And as I said last time, not only did he give her us from the cross, he knew that we needed a mother in this life and that this life would be hard. But then the next sentence is just as important, that John took her into his home. Okay, and that is something that sometimes we don't think about. But that means that we are to have her in our hearts, and we are to talk to her as our mother and to pray to her. And when we do this, as I said, the Holy Spirit then, as St. Louis de Montfort says in paragraph 36 of this book, the Holy Spirit flies there when he sees his spouse. See, Mary and the Holy Spirit are spouses. And John Paul II brought that terminology back. It hadn't been used in the church for centuries. For whatever reason, it kind of fell away. But he brought that terminology back, the spousal union of Mary and the Holy Spirit. Okay, so that's number one. And so every good thing that about Jesus, we receive more through the Blessed Mother. Scripture becomes, you know, more alive to us. The teachings of the church that are maybe difficult to understand all of a sudden become crystal clear. I mean, it's really just a wonderful gift that Mary helps us to have. So That's number one. And so then Jesus truly reigns in the world as God intended for him to reign. And then we can be Jesus to others in a much, it's easier to be charitable, like I said, easier to forgive, all these things. Okay, let's go on to the second. I'm going to read paragraphs 2 and 3 together. Question? Okay. I spent a lot of time on this yesterday, so I got to watch the clock here. My watch is upside down. Okay. Paragraphs 2 and 3 have to do with Mary's humility, her profound humility. And humility is fundamental for the spiritual life. You probably all know that. I mean, it's in Scripture, you know, every other page. God resists the proud and, you know, gives his mercy and graces to the humble, lifts up the humble, the lowly. So we have to grow in humility. And all of us have a lot of pride, you know, and sometimes we don't recognize it. And but that's just part of our fallen human nature. And we have to fight it till the day we die. But Mary, obviously, was perfect in humility as Jesus. And all of her attributes come from him. And so when we talk about Mary's responsibilities or her power or this or that, you know, she's the moon who reflects the rays of the sun. So she everything she has is directly reflected from Jesus. So when I talk about anything about her, just keep that in mind. But I'm going to read here paragraphs 2 and 3 together before we look at question number 2. It says, Mary was singularly hidden during her life. It is on this account that the Holy Ghost and the Church call her Alma Mater, Mother, Secret, and Hidden. Her humility was so profound that she had no inclination on earth more powerful or more constant than that of hiding herself, from herself as well as from every other creature, so as to be known to God alone only. He heard her prayers when she begged to be hidden, to be humbled, and to be treated as in all respects poor and of no account. He took pleasure in hiding her from all human creatures, in her conception, in her birth, in her life, in her mysteries, in her resurrection, and in her assumption. Even her parents did not know her, and the angels often asked one another, "Who is that?" Because the Most High either had hidden her from them, or if he did reveal anything, it was nothing compared to what he kept undisclosed. Okay. So I'm so excited because yesterday I was flipping through my St. Faustina's diary, which, by the way, you got to get this book if you don't have it. And read it alongside of True Devotion to Mary because there's so much in here that it lines up with this book. Well, Margie, you won't believe this, but I was flipping through because I have all these little post-it notes. It's the Diary of St. Faustina. Sorry, I guess I should have said that. The Diary of St. Faustina, the Divine Mercy, because Mary's the Mother of Mercy. So, of course, she's intimately connected with the Divine Mercy, and the Divine Mercy Chapel just prayed on rosary beads for a reason, because they're connected, Mary and the Divine Mercy of Jesus. So, anyway, I knew I had some quotes here, a lot, actually, that I wanted to read about humility. But as I was flipping through the book, God let me open to this page. And I love it because, as I was just saying, so much in this book is also in True Devotion to Mary. Well, listen to this. This is St. Faustina. Let's see if this sounds anything like what we just read. It's paragraph 1021. Okay, St. Faustina says, I have such a strong desire to hide myself that I would like to live as though I did not exist. I feel a strange inner urge to hide myself as deeply as possible so as to be known only to the heart of Jesus. I want to be a quiet little dwelling place for Jesus to rest in. I shall admit nothing that might awaken my beloved. My concealment gives me a chance to commune constantly and exclusively with my bridegroom. I commune with creatures insofar as it is pleasing to him. My heart has come to love the Lord with the full force of love, and I know no other love, because it is from the beginning that my soul has sunk deeply in the Lord as in its only treasure. Although outwardly I meet with many sufferings and various adversities, this does not, however, lessen my interior life for a moment, nor disturb my inner silence. I do not fear at all being abandoned by creatures, because even if all abandoned me, I would not be alone, for the Lord is with me. So, oh, wow, I'm reading this because this is what Mary's heart was. It wasn't like a, you know, a hiding from the world so much because we're in the world. But it's this, and I said this last time, and I'm going to say it a lot this year, but we have to learn to have silent time in our interior, in our home, where the Trinity dwells. It's like, you know, the kingdom of God is within us. You know, we don't have to go searching for it. Close your eyes and you're there. And so this whole hiding, and St. Paul has I don't know what the verse is, but a line in scripture that to be hidden in Christ with God. You know, and I'm going to encourage you. I had a lady in my Tuesday group who came up to me after the last meeting and said, you know, the sisters always taught us growing up to spend 5 minutes a day in silence with your eyes closed. And she said, and I've always done that. And I had 8 children. And I would just tell my children, I need to go spend my 5 minutes with the Lord. And I would go in my room. And I thought, you know, that is so fundamental to us having strength when hardships come. And be able to find that little refuge, that place to go, and close your eyes. And if you haven't started doing that, I started doing this last year. I always knew it was a good idea, but as you know, there's someone who doesn't want us doing this, right? So he's always distracting us, and you know, it makes it impossible for us to do it. But I remember about 20 years ago, I read, I think I said this last time, but I was reading a book of, I can't think of his name. But anyway, he was talking about listening to the Holy Spirit. And he was talking about, I walk in a hospital, and the Holy Spirit will tell me to go in this room. And I will go in that room, and then he'll tell me what to say. And I'll be like, what in the world? How, I want to be able to do that, you know? But it's because it starts with having that quiet time of going into yourself and being with Jesus. And when you have, that's how you get to know him. I mean, we obviously all go to Mass, you know, every week, and maybe some of us go to daily Mass. But really to sit longer than you can, you know, if you can sit a little bit longer after communion, or, you know, it doesn't have to even be in the church. But I'm going to be saying this a lot this year. You're going to get tired of me saying it. But as I said last time, Mary led me to read a book over the summer called A Mother's Plea, and the whole book was about having this quiet time as a refuge, as a safe place to go when you're suffering, you know, and we all have sufferings, and we're going to have sufferings in the future. And so it's just, it's like it's so simple, but yet, so why is it so difficult? Well, someone told me yesterday there's actually a website to help you called, I can't think of the name of it. Sacred Space. And it kind of, I don't know, sacredspace.com or I don't know. It's not? Well, anyway, I'll find out what it is. But it kind of leads you through the steps of, this lady said, of quieting yourself. Because it's hard. I mean, I know it's hard to quiet yourself and you got all these distractions. But I sit after Mass. Like I said, I just started doing it last year because my baby was in first grade and I never could do it at home very well. So I sit after Mass every day and it has absolutely changed my life. I mean, unbelievable. So, you know, I highly encourage you to do that. But anyway, this is what, going back to the book, this is why Mary, reading St. Faustina, sheds a lot of light on this whole idea of just being hidden. But let's look at the question. Well, you know, I'm sorry, before we look at the question, I have a few comments to make about the paragraphs. Okay. Sacredspace.ie.com. Okay, I have not looked at it yet, so I don't know, but I like to investigate things before I just, oh, no, no com, okay, .ie. I generally don't like to recommend books or anything until I've looked at them myself, so I've gotten in trouble doing that. So I haven't looked at this yet, so, you know, I'm assuming it's, the lady who recommended it is a very devout Catholic woman, so I'm assuming it's good, but I just want to put that note out there that I have not myself looked at it. But anyway, I just want to comment here on Alma Mater. We often think of our college we went to or whatever, and that's the Latin translation, and meaning fostering mother, you know, our college. But this is the Hebrew translation, which means mother, secret and hidden. And I want you to write in your book, whenever you see the word secret, write the word mystery, because
St. Louis de Montfort uses the word secret, so it's not like, ooh, it's a secret nobody can know except me and you. It's not like that, you know. It's that it's mysterious. It's a mystery. It's hard to understand, and that we probably won't understand it in this life, okay? And then when you see the word hidden, write the word unknown. So it's kind of, you know, the same idea. We're finite, our minds, our intelligence, and we're not going to be able to search the depths of everything about Mary, certainly about God, right? Well, Mary being, as Father Basil says, almost infinite in holiness, we're not going to be able to understand her in this life, you know, her virtues. And she's so far beyond and above all the angels and saints that, you know, we can get an idea of, you know, as we grow in holiness, what the saints were like. But she's so far beyond in her infinite in all her virtues that we won't be able to. And so that's kind of what he's saying here. Her humility was so profound that even her parents, you know, didn't. Even the angels say, who is that? This person who's so, you know, just the glow that must have come from her, so beautiful. And actually the Legion of Mary has a prayer that my mom always rattles off at the end of the rosary growing up. I can never, she says it so fast, but who is she who comes forth as the morning rising? Some of you know this, fair as the moon, bright as the sun, you know, terrible as a battle, set in army array. Anyway, same idea. That's where they get that prayer is, who is this unbelievable person, you know, who's just so beautiful? So that's what he's saying. So basically he's saying that God, and I'm just reading here part of paragraph 3, he took pleasure in hiding her from all human creatures so as to make her known only to himself. So it's like his little, you know, I don't want to use the word secret, but he made her so incredibly beautiful that no one can possibly enjoy her or understand her except for God, because she's just so far beyond us. We have a lot to look forward to when we get to heaven, is understanding the fullness of who she really is. You know, it's going to blow us away when we see all that. Okay, I think that's all I wanted to say about the paragraphs here. Let's look at the question. Okay. All right. I gotta talk fast here, get through all this. St. Louis de Montfort begins in paragraph number 2 by focusing on Mary's profound humility. I'm reading question number 2 from the study questions. Even stating in paragraph 3 that Mary begged the Lord to hide her, our pride naturally causes us to desire to be seen, not hidden. Imagine this kind of humility. Could this be used to explain why there is not much written about Mary in the Bible, something for Protestants to ponder, since they often ask, where does it say that about Mary in the Bible? Why do you think Mary wanted to hide herself even from herself? Was she aware of her greatness? Consider the quote, I love this, from Father John Ziegler. The thing about humility is that once you realize you have it, you've already lost it. Humility is an extremely mysterious virtue. You can't, like, put your finger on it, because as soon as you think you're being humble, then you have pride. So, all right. First, to answer a couple of these questions here. Yes, it's true, and we'll read it actually in the next couple of paragraphs here, that Mary didn't want the focus on herself in the Bible because of her profound humility. Her focus was on, she wanted to be in the background, and so that only a little as much could be said about her that had to be said to make Jesus known. And she wanted that, and God granted her that request, as we'll see in the next paragraph. Or I think as we already read, that he consented to her humility, her request. Because God always loves a humble heart. And as we'll read, I'm going to read you some quotes from St. Faustina here in a minute, that he answers the prayers of a humble soul. He'll do miracles for humble souls. So we, you know, it's to our benefit to grow in humility, not for selfish reasons, but because usually the more you grow in humility, the what you ask for is God's will anyway. So why does she want to hide herself even from herself? I think that what he's saying there is that her focus, she doesn't want to focus on herself. Her focus is always outward toward Christ. So she didn't ever want to focus on herself. Was she aware of her greatness? Absolutely. You know, she knew she was the mother of God. Part of humility is knowing the truth about yourself. Okay, so she wasn't boasting when she said, all generations shall call me blessed, or, you know, the Lord has done great things for me. That's just the truth. Okay, so I think a lot, we sometimes think that we're bragging when we, you know, I have the gift of teaching. You know, I wouldn't have been able to say that a few years ago because I thought, oh, it just sounds so boastful. But no, it's a gift God's given me, you know, and I just am saying that I have it, and I'm extremely grateful for it. You know, when I step down from here and go home, I'm not that like this. I mean, you know, like I have this gift, and I don't necessarily live my life just teaching and preaching to my family. You know, they'd kill me. I mean, I try, but they don't listen. You know, those closest to you want you to go away, you know. But anyway, did she know? Yes, she knew that she was her extreme dignity as a child of God. She knew of her, you know, extreme dignity and honor as being the mother of God. So yes, she knew that. But even more than John the Baptist, she wanted to decrease so that he could increase. I don't even know if she could decrease any more than she had, because she was so 100% transparent to herself. But she had free will. I have people say to me, and we're going to talk about Adam and Eve here in a minute, you know, I had a lady say, well, it's just not fair to try to imitate Mary, because she was immaculately conceived, and she never sinned, and how can we even aspire to that? And I try to remind people that, well, Adam and Eve also were immaculately conceived. So she had a free will, and she always chose to do God's will. So we have to, you know, of course she had a tremendous amount of grace, but Adam and Eve were also conceived without sin. They didn't have original sin, wasn't around yet, right, when they were created. That came after. So it's still, she chose to do God's will. Okay. All right, let's talk about humility. What is humility? As I said, it's a mystery. It's kind of a funny thing, because it seems like all the humble people think they're proud, and all the proud people think they're humble. I don't know, that's just been my observation. Okay, I don't even know where to start. I have so much written down here about humility and where to start. So, all right, I'll just focus on this whole truth thing. All right, a couple quotes that I looked up. Well, first of all, I used to just throw out there, humility is truth. Okay, and Father Basil Cole said, actually, truth's a whole lot more than just that, which obviously I know that, but he's like, humility has an element of truth to it, yes, but you can't just say humility is truth, okay? So I'm going to like correct that a little bit and say that the truth is, what humility is the truth of who you are in relation to God and others, the truth of who you are, okay? So there's, and this is interesting, there are two things that oppose humility. And number one is pride, but guess what number two is? False humility. All right? And a lot of people have false humility, and it's very damaging. Okay? And we have to get away from false humility, okay? Because it feels virtuous, but it's not. All right? Now let me explain. Here's the truth of who we are. We are unbelievably beautiful in the eyes of God. We are beloved, precious children. We are daughters and sons of the King of the universe if we've been baptized. All right, even if we haven't been baptized, we're made in his image and likeness. Our dignity, as we all know in the pro-life movement, our dignity as human persons is sacred. All right, I think we forget about that sometimes, how beloved we are, okay? We have also received many gifts. All of us have. All right? The problem with false humility is you don't use your gifts a lot of times because you think, I'm not good enough. I'm not worthy. Well, I have a secret. None of us are worthy. We got to get over that. None of us are worthy. All right? We say it at Mass, Lord, I am not worthy. You know, on Ash Wednesday, we were dust, unto dust. You know, I mean, it's okay. You know, we're not worthy, but that's okay. Don't let that stop you. What we have to realize is my third point. So number one, we're beloved, beautiful, precious children of God. Number two, we've been given many, many gifts. And number three, we are extremely weak because of our fallen nature. And number four, we are in desperate need of God's help. Okay? That's humility. And that shouldn't make you feel bad about yourself, okay? It's acknowledging that we're weak because of our fallen human nature, all right? Humanity is good. God created us to be good. But after original sin, we have a darkening of the intellect and a weakening of the will. And so this is something I want to make sure that this is different from last year, from the last 7 years that I'm so excited to understand now. But what I used to say, or what I actually just by reading some quotes from some of the saints, one of them being St. John Eudes, which I'm going to read to you here in a minute, I used to say that of ourselves, we can do nothing good, that we need God's grace, that Jesus says only God is good in Scripture. So all goodness comes from God. So our thoughts, our words, our good actions, that we need God for that. Okay, Father Basil, straighten me out, and I'm very excited to share this with you because I was a little off. And you're going to love this. Okay, here's what it is. We were created to be good. God created humanity to be good. And even after the fall, we are still, our human nature is fallen, but good. This is what the Catholic Church teaches. Some of the heresies down through the centuries, Calvinism and some of those, were that human nature is radically corrupt. That is not true, okay? But here's the part I was missing, and that is that you have to have God's grace to save yourself. I mean, you can't save yourself by yourself because God created us good, but we can't get to heaven just by being good, because otherwise Jesus wouldn't have had to come and die on the cross. So we needed something addition to the goodness that he already created us to be. This is why people in mortal sin can still do good. All right, they've lost all grace. They're not living in a state of grace, but they do lots of good, right? I mean, they love their families, and, you know, we all know people. Although I want to say something I didn't say yesterday is that we don't know if someone's in the state of mortal sin. You know, the three factors are they has to be doing something grave, they have to know it's grave, and they have to get full consent of the will. And so we might be worried about someone in the state of mortal sin, but they might not have those last two things, okay? So here's the thing. You can still do good. You could, you know nothing of Christ or turn your back on Christ or whatever, be in the state, and still do good. So you have no grace at that point. But you need grace, God's grace, then to purify the good that you do, because in and of ourselves, we tend to corrupt the good that we do. And that's why we'll go on corrupting the good that we do, and so without God's grace, we're not going to make it to heaven. So we have selfish desires. I might say to my neighbor, oh, I'll buy you and your family a plane ticket, you know, to go on vacation. But in my mind, I'm thinking, because you drive me nuts, and I want you gone for a week. You know, like, our good intentions are often stained with selfishness, right? So they're not pure. So we need God, not to say that there aren't some people out of the state of grace who have truly altruistic, you know, good deeds. But typically, our human nature corrupts our good deeds, okay? So we need grace to do. So here's another way of saying what I used to say, which is, of ourselves, we can do nothing good. The way to say it, and what you write down, is, of ourselves, we can do nothing meritorious, okay? We can't gain merit by ourselves. Okay, the Catechism says that people in the state of mortal sin, their good works are not meritorious, unfortunately. Now, again, before you start worrying about all the people you think are in the state of mortal sin, and you know, we often say, oh, at least they're doing this, and at least they're doing these good works, and now I'm saying that those don't even count. Again, we don't know if they're in the state of mortal sin, number one. And number two, they can still receive what's called actual grace. Some of you have heard that term. Thank you. Actual grace is momentary grace that is given to people by your prayers. And then not to mention you have the daily mass going on all over the world that's obtaining graces for the entire world. So this is how people who are in the state of mortal sin come out of the state of mortal sin, is actual graces are given to them. Now you have to cooperate with grace, right? You have to cooperate. So we do have to do our part. That's why we do have to struggle and work hard, and we can't just say, oh, it's all God's grace. No, it's a cooperation with grace, okay? Now, I'm going to read to you this thing by St. John Eudes, which is where I got this whole idea of we can do nothing by ourselves without God's grace. And so wherever it says we can do nothing good, I'm going to insert the word meritorious. Okay, you understand the difference, right? Okay. Isn't this great? It's just like, I'm so happy to finally get this right. Because I guess I was teaching Calvinism before. So we got to get all those people back from last year. Okay, this is St. John Eudes, who promoted the devotion to the Immaculate Heart of Mary. He says, let us consider attentively these truths. He says, first of all, of ourselves we can do nothing pleasing to God. We can do nothing meritorious, pleasing to God. And then he quotes Scripture, John 15:5. Without me, you can do nothing. I mean, it's even in Scripture. But what the Lord means is you can't gain heaven. Okay? Secondly, we cannot speak a good word on our own. See? Without grace, we cannot speak a meritorious word. And this is in Matthew 12:34, where Jesus says, O generation of vipers, how can you speak good things whereas you are evil? And then he goes on, this is scripture too, no man can say the Lord Jesus except by the Holy Spirit. So we can't even have faith without grace. Okay. Fourthly, we cannot have a good thought, a meritorious thought, without the grace of God. And then he quotes 2 Corinthians 3:5. Not that we are sufficient to think anything of ourselves as of ourselves, but our sufficiency is from God. Lastly, we cannot perform the least good action of Christian virtue, nor resist the slightest temptation in the world, even for a moment, by ourselves without God's grace. Okay, so without grace, you're going to fall into temptation a lot easier. You know, you're not going to have that shield that grace gives us. So this is what he says. He concludes by saying, what a source of humiliation for us, but this is what I like. Let us rejoice in this abjection and engrave these truths deeply upon our minds so that this is what is so important, that everywhere and always we may acknowledge our futility and our great need of God. This will compel us to have recourse to him continually, pray without ceasing, saying frequently, O God, come to my assistance, O Lord, make haste to help me. So we should be praying a lot more than we do for God's assistance throughout the day, you know. So if we're just saying our morning prayer, which is good, obviously, it encompasses the whole day, but, you know, really, to know that you're weak and that you can't save yourself, you can't just work your way into heaven. I mean, obviously, works are important, but we'll talk later this year about that God plans works for you, and you walk in those works to do, and that's following his will. It's not that we, if I do this and that, I'll get to heaven. No, it's that God gives us works to do. We obey him by doing them. We don't try to think of our own works. You know, this is why we have this open communication, this ability to hear the Spirit. And then he tells you, go there, do this, do that. Because if you're thinking of it all on your own and you're not asking for God's grace, you might abandon your family and go do something, when what you should be doing is staying home with your family, because your duties of your state are your absolute very first and most important thing in life, unless the Holy Spirit gives you a special grace to go out and do something else, like me doing this. You know, I was told by the Lord to do this. I was asked, this wasn't my idea, believe me. I have 5 kids, I'm busy, and so, but it was a calling, and I was invited to do this, and I prayed about it, and so, yeah, I've made mistakes and have neglected my family at times, but for the most part, I just wing it, and it just, things fall into place, and Mary's helped me to better my ability to never do this ahead of something that my family wants, okay? So sometimes there is a grace, as we all know, to go out and do things, especially once our kids are gone. Okay, so I just want to read to you a couple of things that St. Faustina said about humility. And actually, before I do that, I looked up humility for the first time. The definitions of truth, and then Father Hardin says humility is sanity, humility is living in reality. You know, those things just kind of came to me on the radio one day. But I thought, well, I'll look it up. So here's one definition. Humility is a supernatural virtue, okay? It's a gift, so we have to ask for it. And we're going to look at the litany of humility here in a minute, which people don't like. But does anyone have a tissue? I thought I had one in my pocket, but I don't. Thank you. Okay. Part of humility is self-knowledge. Thank you. Thank you. And we're going to talk a lot about that. As a matter of fact, when we do the 33 days of prayer in preparation for a consecration in the spring, one of the weeks is focusing on self-knowledge. Who am I? And that's what humility is the truth of who we are. So I'm going to read this definition. It says, humility is a supernatural virtue which through the self-knowledge it imparts inclines us to reckon ourselves at our true worth and to seek self-effacement and contempt. Now what that means is of sin. Okay, not our dignity, but we seek to rid ourselves of sin, to die to self, as Jesus tells us to do. Those who hate themselves will save themselves in the end. So this word, when you see the word hate in the book, it always refers to sin. Okay, it's never that we hate ourselves, because Jesus says, love your neighbor as yourself. So we love ourselves, but it's this, you know, disproportionate love of self is what we want to get rid of, that we want to die to. Okay, it says, humility is based both in truth and in justice. Truth causes us to know ourselves just as we are, and justice inclines us to act upon that knowledge. It's okay. And then I found this. It says, humility comes from the word humus, which means soil, which means of the earth. So it's a lowering of ourself, you know, not in a bad way. But it's placing ourselves at the service of others. You know, it's giving the other person the higher place, as it says in Scripture over and over. It says, so we need good soil to bear good fruit. So we have to spend some time in the soil to bear good fruit. Then this one says, humility is the foundation of the spiritual edifice. It's the first virtue, inasmuch as it removes obstacles to faith. Now, it's not the greatest virtue. It's not Mary's greatest virtue. It's not Jesus' greatest virtue. The greatest virtues are faith, hope, and love, charity. Okay, the theological virtues are first. Okay, but you have to have humility as a foundational virtue to grow in all the other virtues. Okay, it says it removes pride and makes a man subject to and a fit recipient of grace. According to the words of St. James, God resists the proud and gives his grace to the humble. Now, this was my favorite one that I found. And, of course, it's Father John Harden. And I'm reading it. I'm like, this is great. This is really good. Father John Harden, of course. I love Father John Harden so much. And I pray for his canonization because I think someday he will be canonized a saint. It says, humility is a moral virtue that keeps a person from reaching beyond himself. Now, obviously, we're supposed to be the best we can be, but this is a, you know, disproportionate kind of reaching. It is a virtue that restrains the unruly desire for personal greatness, and it leads people to an orderly love. Okay, not a disorderly love, but an orderly love of themselves based on a true appreciation of their position with respect to God and their neighbors. Okay, that's a beautiful definition. It says, religious humility, so I'm taking it deeper for us, recognizes one's total dependence on God to get to heaven, okay, or for all good things. It recognizes your equality with all of God's children. Now, this is my what I just said a minute ago, but it says, humility is not only opposed to pride, it is also opposed to an immoderate self-abjection, which would fail to recognize God's gifts and use them according to his will. So again, that is so, so important that people have a false humility, and I understand where it comes from. A lot of times it's just an insecurity, and I was extremely insecure, and we all suffered as youth from the hands of our parents, and you know, we all carry that into adulthood. But the good news about Mary is she wants to heal you of all that, so that you can be bold and speak the truth and not worry what people think about you. And so we're going to look at the litany of humility here in a minute, but true humility says, I can't, but with God's grace, I can. False humility just says, I can't. You see the difference? Yeah, that's what the martyrs have, right? And St. Paul says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So listen, God wants to really use you. It doesn't matter what you've done in the past. I mean, look at St. Paul. He was a murderer. It doesn't matter what you've done in the past, what your sins are. Every day is a new day. Every day is you are made into a new creation. I mean, once you've gone to confession, let it go and accept that God wants to use you. Believe me, you are all here for a reason. And we all know the world needs saints right now, and God is raising up his army through Mary. So I just want to say this again, please don't drop out, unless you have to for whatever reason. But I say that, and I've never said this before because it sounds like I'm bragging. I don't want you to miss my teaching. And I don't mean that at all. I just, January 1st, 2012, Mary put on my heart that I have to bring as many souls as I can to her and fast. And so usually what happens is in the beginning of true devotion like this, I have a really large crowd. And then as the months go on, people fall behind in their reading and they stop coming. And I don't want you to do that. It doesn't matter if you don't even own the book, really. I'm serious. If you don't read one single thing or look at one single study question, stick with it. Consecrate yourselves at the end of the year because Mary wants to use you. She wants to use you now, but especially she wants to form you into her soldier so that you can go out and do miraculous things. Do you know that we are called to do miraculous things? We can't do it on our own. Forget it. I can't sit up here on my own strength. Are you kidding? But I empty myself of myself. It's like I check Ann out at the door, and I come in, and I ask the Holy Spirit to work through me. And that's how we are needed desperately in the world right now. So it's this closeness to Mary. She's like your guide and your counselor in union with the Holy Spirit, and she'll tell you what to do. And so don't think for a minute that because of your past life or whatever it is that you're unworthy. You know, I had a lady say, I'm unworthy to even be in this room with all these holy people. You know, don't think that, because we're all sinners. Terrible sinners, some of us. I mean, I'm glad you didn't know me in college. You know, thank God for the new day. But we're all sinners, and we're all weak, you know. I mean, so it's just a matter of saying no to yourself and yes to God. And Mary just helps you to do that in a more profound way. Okay. Two things I got to make sure I look at, and that's the litany of humility, which we're not going to have time to read the whole thing, but I just want to briefly look at it. Yesterday we prayed it out loud, but I just want you to look at. If you look at the litany of humility, now again, good old Father Basil said, you have had me in the past, know why I'm laughing, okay, because I've been doing this for 7 years, and I've been saying things one way. Okay, here's what Father Basil has to say about the litany of humility. It's a difficult prayer to pray. God answers this prayer. So you start praying it, and the next thing you know, the most humiliating thing will happen to you. And I have people coming to me all the time saying, oh my gosh, you just can't believe how humiliating. I'm like, I know, it happens all the time to me. That's why I hate the prayer, you know. But it brings tremendous joy after a while, you know, like in the beginning it hurts, you know, because of our pride and we don't like to, and it's not like, humility isn't all about humiliating things happening to you, obviously, but God wants to knock our pride down a little bit so that we can say, not of my own strength am I doing this, but only on your strength, okay? So anyway, Father Basil, if you'll notice that this prayer is divided into three parts. The first part is from the desire of something, of being loved, of being extolled, of being honored, praised, on and on. Okay, Father Basil Cole said that he's talking about excessive, disproportionate, and unreasonable desires. Okay, we all desire to be loved because that's how God created us. Okay, so that, you can't read that and say, you know, I want you to free me from the desire of being loved. Okay. Now he's talking about excessiveness. Okay. So when you read this prayer, so maybe we already knew that when we were praying this, but anyway, I want to make sure I said it. And he says, Father Basil also says that you're not talking about the emotions here, because our emotions are part of our humanity and we can't help it. You know, when we feel sad sometimes, I mean, healing of the heart can help you not feel hurt sometimes. We'll talk about healing of the heart as the year goes on, because that's, Mary wants us all healed, you know, so that the darts that come at us don't hurt us anymore, okay? We'll talk about that as the year goes on. But this is not about the emotions that you're going to have sometimes, and it's not even about reasonable desires or motivating fears, okay? Some fears are motivating. They get us moving, right? Okay, so that being said, We pray the litany of humility, and I encourage you, during the 33 days, I encourage everyone to pray it every day, which it's like the 33 days are hard enough. You're going to add the litany of humility, but, it's a good prayer to pray as often as you can. But freed from the desire of being excessively loved, extolled, honored, praised, preferred, and then the next part is fear. And so desire and fear are two sides of the same coin. Because if you desire to be honored, you fear being rejected. You see? They're the same kind of thing. So this whole second part there is a fear of being humiliated, despised, suffering rebukes. And, as I said, we're all on a human, our human nature is going to not want to be, humiliated, despised, and all this stuff. But so we're talking about, but we can get to that level. And when I was reading, we read the whole prayer yesterday, and I just have to say that the thought that ran through my mind as we were praying this out loud yesterday is that now that I spend that quiet time with Jesus every day, all this goes away. These fears and these desires start to go away because I just close my eyes and just go be with Jesus, and he's there, to comfort me. Because people are going to let us down. It doesn't matter who it is, And so, that's just something that I noticed this year. And then the last part then, again, is placing others above you. And something that has helped me in the past praying this prayer is to, if there's a certain person I'm having a problem with, no names mentioned, in my family, but I'll insert their name. And it really does help. So Jesus, from the desire of being praised by so-and-so, or from the fear of being, ridiculed by so-and-so, I'll say their name. And then that kind of focuses in on a person. It really helps, okay? So we have to grow in humility. It's not fun, but in the end, it brings a tremendous amount of joy because you don't have the desire to be this or that, nor do you have the fear of whatever it is. And so, what can you do then? You can go out and be a bold apostle for Christ, right? I mean, you're able to evangelize much better because you're not worried about what people think. Now, that's a lifetime to accomplish, truly having absolutely no fear or no desire what people think about you. Because, obviously I still worry about that from time to time. But what I do know is by growing in humility, it does give you a greater boldness. And so what we said before, using the gifts God gave you. He intends you to use them. But see, we put blocks because of our fear and pride. Okay, now I'm going to just, I could talk all day about humility. I won't keep, we'll come back to it a lot this year. But it is foundational for this devotion. I'll just end by reading a couple of quotes from St. Faustina again. I'll tell you what they are. Just seeing if I missed anything here. The motto of a humble person is, except for the grace of God, there go I. So we want to make sure that we have that in our heart. Being humble helps you not to get hurt so much, and it helps you not to judge people. Because you could be in that same person's shoes and be a heck of a lot worse. I heard a priest say that one time. If you were in that person's shoes, you might be way meaner. So we got to try not to judge people, and that humility helps us to have compassion. Okay, so St. Faustina, I'll just go through a couple of these. She's so awesome. This is 1092. Now, this is the truth, too. You have to really meditate on this. It says, and I'm not reading the whole thing here, but it says, the more a soul humbles itself, the greater the kindness with which the Lord approaches it. Okay, I'm going to use my elbow here. Love this one. It says, and we haven't even gotten here in the book yet, Margie, but she's in my familia, and we're reading this book. We're on our fifth year, I think, or sixth year. It's taken us forever to get through it, but we talk too much. Imagine that, a group of ladies. Okay, this is 1711. It says, when I was left alone with the Blessed Virgin, she instructed me concerning the interior life. So the interior life is simply that, closing your eyes and talking to the Lord, praying. She said, The soul's true greatness is in loving God and in humbling oneself in his presence, completely forgetting oneself and believing oneself to be nothing because the Lord is great. But he is well pleased only with the humble. The proud he always opposes. Okay, so again, we know this, but this is my favorite. I'm saving it for the end, make sure I didn't miss anything. Oh, I did. This is another quote from the Blessed Mother to St. Faustina, 14:15. It says, I desire, my dearly beloved daughter, that you practice the three virtues that are dearest to me and most pleasing to God. The first is humility, humility, and once again, humility. But that's still just number one. At first, it sounds like that's number one, two, and three. The second is purity. And the third is love of God. As my daughter, you must especially radiate with these virtues. And I love this. When the conversation ended, she pressed me to her heart and disappeared. Oh, so beautiful. Okay, now this is one, though, that I always save, like the real, the zinger here at the end. This is 1306. It says, O humility, lovely flower, I see how few souls possess you. Is it because you are so beautiful and at the same time so difficult to attain? Oh yes, it is both the one and the other. Even God takes great pleasure in her, and her being a humble soul. Now this, remember this, the floodgates of heaven are open to a humble soul, and a sea of graces flow down upon her. Oh, how beautiful is a humble soul. From her heart, as from a censer, rises a varied and most pleasing fragrance, which breaks through the skies and reaches God himself, filling his most sacred heart with joy. God refuses nothing to such a soul. She is all-powerful and influences the destiny of the whole world. Powerful. God raises such a soul up to his very throne, and the more she humbles herself, the more God stoops down to her, pursuing her with his graces and accompanying her at every moment with his omnipotence. Such a soul is most deeply united with God. O humility, strike deep roots in my whole being. O virgin most pure, but also most humble, help me to attain a deep humility. Now I understand why there are so few saints. It is because so few souls are deeply humble. So don't be afraid of humility, because the benefits are amazing. You know, and like a few paragraphs later, her, St. Faustina, being so humble, she asks, like, I forget what it is now, but she asks Jesus, oh, will you let no souls die today in Poland? He's like, okay. So it's like we don't realize that we have a certain power, and we're talking about the Blessed Mother's power, and it's like God wants to reward us. You know, we think of God up there sometimes as this just judge, and he's keeping track of all the things we've done wrong, and, you know, we get bogged down with that negative thinking of God, and he just wants to share his not only his love and his mercy, but his power with us. You know, we're different from the rest of the world. I always tell my kids. They're like, it's not fair because we're the only kids who don't have a cell phone. And I'm like, look, we're different. You know, we're Catholic, and we have extra graces to walk the narrow path. And so, you know, it's not going to be easy, but we're going to try really hard to walk that narrow path, and we can do it. So anyway, it's worth the effort. It's hard, though, you know, and I believe me, whew, it's hard, you know. There's some nights I go to bed, I'm like, oh, it was really hard to grow in humility, but it's so worth it. The peace and the joy that it brings is just unbelievable. Okay, enough of that for now. We got to move on. Okay, so we can hopefully get through the rest of the book, or the rest of the assignment today. We might have to go a few minutes over, but if you have to leave right at 11:30, let me know, and I can email you. You know, again, if you miss a meeting and you want the notes, and maybe at some point we can even have the video available. I don't know yet about that, but let me know, and I can give you the notes. Of course, I have to go and add all the new stuff, so it takes a while. So Sometimes you get it like the day of. No, I try to do it sooner than the day of the next meeting. But okay, we are on paragraph number 4. And circle this because this starts a whole new theme now. Okay? And what the theme is here, I want you to write in Trinity. Paragraph number 4 begins what we're going to go through the next meeting, and maybe the next meeting is the deepest part of the book. I mean, it's really, I have to struggle when I'm reading it myself, like, oh gosh, just help me to be able to explain this because it's so theological, okay? It's the relationship of each person of the Trinity and their relationship with Mary and how much they love her and, you know, what she means to them and the gifts they've given her. And some of these gifts are like, wow, like, you maybe never even thought of before. Okay, so if you look at number 4, he usually separates them out. God the Father usually is first, and then God the Son, and then God the Holy Spirit. So when you see the word consented here, it means agreed. So again, you know, Mary asked to be humble and asked to be hidden. She didn't want the focus to be on herself. She's the last person who wants the focus to be on herself. Just as I said, she's the last person who wants to keep your prayers. You know, she's not like hoarding them. She gives them directly to the Lord. No time passes. Someone said, well, last week, well, wouldn't it be faster just to go to Jesus? There's no difference in the amount of time your prayer gets to Jesus. Because if you stand on one side of a window, you know, with a screen, I guess, open, talking to someone, that nothing slows down. It's just the benefit of your, the beauty that your prayers take on going through her is what we're seeking. Okay. 4, God the Father consented that she should work no miracle, at least no public one, during her life, although he had given her the power to do so. God the Son consented that she should hardly ever speak, though he had communicated his wisdom to her. God the Holy Ghost, though she was his faithful spouse, consented that his apostles, and evangelists should speak very little of her and no more than was necessary to make Jesus Christ known. So again, it was a consenting. It was a, Mary asked for all of these things. Let's look at the question, number 3. It says, it is in paragraph 4 where St. Louis de Montfort first mentions a relationship between Mary and the Blessed Trinity. He says that God the Father gave Mary the power to perform miracles. This may sound strange at first, but if we consider what Jesus said in the mustard seed parable, it is easy to believe that Mary had enough faith to move mountains. Do you think she knew she had this power, and do you think she ever used it? Well, we'll look at each person of the Trinity. So I don't want to forget about what Jesus and the Holy Spirit, so I'm going to do them first, and we'll come back to this question with God the Father, who gave her the power to work miracles. But Jesus says that she should hardly ever speak, and though he had communicated his wisdom to her. And what St. Louis de Montfort says is that in her womb, those 9 months, he communicated such wisdom to her that she was full of grace before the incarnation. Do you ever think about that? So then what was she after the incarnation? Well, the church calls it the double plenitude of grace. So she was even more so. But we'll talk about that later in the year. And then it says, as we already mentioned, that the Holy Spirit consented that she speak very little through the evangelists, only to make Christ known. Okay, now that was then, this is now. Now she needs to be made known. That's, you know, that's God's desire. But then, at the time of Scripture, it was so that the focus wouldn't be on her. But look, what about God the Father? Okay, question number 3. First of all, as I said before, all of her power, number 1, was a gift. Okay, he gives us power too. And number, so that's first thing to keep in mind. All her power, it comes from God. Okay, and secondly, we know she had perfect faith. Her faith was infinite almost infinite. And so, of course, she had faith to move mountains. She was also full of all the gifts of the Spirit, and she had the charisms of the Spirit. So she had the gift of prophecy and gift of healing and all these different gifts. Why wouldn't she? The apostles drove out demons and cured the sick. And so why wouldn't Mary have that power? But she did not use it. Preternatural, which are... bilocation, right. She had all the gifts that the church gives, except... the priesthood, Father Basil said. She didn't have the priesthood. But anyway, she gave birth to the priesthood. So, no, I'm just teasing. He did say that. But when I was talking about her having all the gifts of God and all the gifts of the Spirit and all the charisms, and But so she did. So, of course, it really isn't a far stretch to think that she could have done miracles. But, again, back to her humility, there's no way she was going to do a public miracle and draw attention to herself, because that's what it would have done, right? But, I mean, I just feel that through her prayers of intercession, probably lots of miracles of healing and conversion took place of her neighbors and where she lived. And so, but that was everything that happened was all attributed to God's grace and not herself, as any miracles that come through our prayers are all God's grace and not of ourselves. So, power comes from God. She knew that with God all things are possible. So she believed in miracles and that. And then we don't want to forget about the God incidents miracles. Those are miracles too, you know, that she had those in her life. And I speak about that last week, God incidences. But anyway, that's just all the things that seem like a coincidence or what the world calls a coincidence. And, you know, it was so cute. I just have to share this. I don't have time to share it, but I'm going to. My son, who's a sophomore at Mueller, the teacher said, does anybody want to, parents want to come in and speak about Jesus? I'm like, well, sure. You know, I was the only parent that agreed to do it. And so I went in, and he told me I had 5 minutes. I'm like, oh my gosh, how I can't. 5 minutes. It turned out there was a panel of five of us, all men, teachers, and me, a mom, and all boys. And so obviously I talked about the Eucharist and talked about, I read parts of a Eucharistic miracle, but I just began talking about God incidences and that God speaks to us through those little coincidences that happen. Anyway, one of the students emailed me yesterday and said, Mrs. Collins, I'm so happy that you said that about God incidences, because now I'm seeing them all the time. If it hadn't been for you, I would have never made the connection that was God. So, oh, such just so sweet. Anyway, I had to share that because people don't know. You know, people don't realize that there are no such thing as coincidences, that God is trying to speak to you. He has a message for you. Sometimes you don't know what the message is. It doesn't matter what the message is. It's just that God loves you. You know, sometimes there's a message there. Like if a scripture verse tells you to do something and then you like hear it again and I better do that. But, you know, most of the times there's no message associated. It's just that God loves you and he's letting you know that he's thinking of you at every second. So, all right, where was I? All right, so let's go on. This paragraph is a great one because, again, I think thanks to being a Catholic and having the church fathers interpret scripture for us, you know, we're not left to interpret scripture on our own. And this is a great gift. And this is one of the things where paragraph five discusses how Jesus calls his mother woman. Oftentimes, and we, you know, we hear people say, oh, they must not have been close, or, you know, it almost sounds disrespectful. Well, let's read this, and then I'll say what the church fathers have to say about that. Five, Mary is the excellent masterpiece of the Most High, the knowledge and possession of which he has reserved for himself. We said that already. Mary is the admirable mother of the Son, who took pleasure in humbling and concealing her during her life in order to favor her humility, calling her by the name of woman, as if she were a stranger, although in his heart he esteemed and loved her above all angels and all men. Mary is the sealed fountain, the faithful spouse of the Holy Ghost, to whom he alone has entrance. Mary is the sanctuary and the repose of the Holy Trinity, where God dwells more magnificently and more divinely than in any other place in the universe, not excepting his dwelling between the cherubim and the seraphim. Nor is any creature, no matter how pure, allowed to enter into that sanctuary except by a great and special privilege. So, you know, it's just so beautiful that in her perfect, immaculate soul, God is more pleased to dwell there than anywhere else in the universe. It's just so beautiful, even between the angels. But let's look at this. The church fathers have to say about Jesus calling, and I don't remember which church father, so don't ask me, but I do remember reading this, that woman, the reason he calls her woman, and now St. Louis de Montfort says here to favor her humility. And so, you know, it could be that he didn't want to point her out during his life, because when he was popular, she might have gotten mobbed, you know. And then at his death, when he's hanging on the cross, people might have, you know, taken her away and crucified her too. Maybe he was protecting her. I don't know. But what the church fathers say is that Jesus uses the word woman not in any disrespectful way at all, but he is showing us that she is the woman. She's the woman. In Genesis, at the beginning of the Bible, in Genesis 3:15, the woman who will crush the head of the serpent. And she is the woman at the end of the Bible in Revelation, clothed with the sun. Now, obviously, she represents the church, the bride of Christ. But isn't that beautiful just to have that interpretation of what Jesus is trying to show us by calling his mother woman, to show us that she is the woman. And that is the exact translation from the Aramaic, is woman. Okay. This whole idea of her being a sealed fountain, now, that has several meanings. I mean, you can think of it, you know, as her perpetual virginity. But really, again, when you see the word sealed, you know, think of it as being like a hidden place, an unknown to the world. You know, we can't understand, the world can't understand Mary, and just her greatness and her beauty. The Holy Spirit will allow us in through a great privilege, which is what it is. So we're going to talk a couple times this year. This comes up a few times, is how do we gain that privilege? Well, it's by those virtues Mary just talked about, humility, purity. Because if you're not pure, you're not going to get Mary. You know, I mean, that's just how it is. Because she's so pure. And you will become more pure through total consecration. Total consecration is truly like a transforming act. When you consecrate yourself to Mary, total consecration. A lot of us have made consecrations, but total consecration, a transformation will take place in you, maybe not overnight, but for some people it is overnight. When I first read the book the first year, I had a transformation take place overnight I was crazy about listening. I mean, I knew the writer of every song ever written. It was like my thing. You know, it came on the radio, we'd have contests. I could name who it was, who sang it. Overnight, I just did not care about that anymore at all. You know, it's amazing. Sometimes it is an immediate thing, but it's usually a journey that you can grow deeper in year after year. Okay, so this whole idea of sealed fountain, as I said, sealed also is a word that is used in the sacraments, several of the sacraments. And sealed means set apart. So in the sacrament of confirmation and baptism, sealed means the mark of God. Okay, it means holy. So she was sealed. And then when we hear the word fountain, we think of, you know, an overflowing fountain, just non-ending, just abundance of grace. And so that's what's so awesome about living in the heart of Mary is that fountain. Like, it's always on. You know, it's like her motherly love and her comfort and her wisdom and her compassion. And, I mean, it's just unbelievable. And she constantly is giving you the gifts of the Spirit. And it's just, that's what it's like to live in the heart of Mary, which is what total consecration leads you to. And that just reminded me of something that I want to read that was in the Magnificat on, I am going to go a few minutes over, I apologize, but so maybe 10 minutes over. Because I want to make sure that I get all this in. But this is in the Magnificat on the Feast of the Assumption. And it says, it's about Mary and the Holy Spirit and that how she gives... First, I want to read this one. This is Pope Benedict. And this is how I said, you know, when you close your eyes and you have the indwelling of the Trinity, right, that we got at baptism. And so Mary's indwelling isn't the same as that, but she's there. Okay, we don't have the indwelling of Mary, but she's there because she's united with God. And so this is what Pope Benedict says. He says, precisely because Mary is with God and in God, she is very close to each one of us. While she lived on this earth, she could only be close to a few people. But being in God, who's actually within all of us, Mary shares in this closeness of God. Our Lady knows our hearts, hears our prayers, can help us with her motherly kindness. She always listens to us, and being the mother of the Son, participates in the power of the Son and in his goodness. We can always entrust the whole of our lives to this mother. So we have another Marian Pope. I mean, do you guys know that? He is extremely Marian as well. What a gift. Okay, and then this is that same day back in the meditations. I meant to read this last week, but wasn't supposed to, I guess. But I got to read it. Okay, now this is the meditation in the back by, did I grab the wrong one? I did. Here it is. This is a Dominican priest, Marie Dominique Philippe He says that Mary, and this is what I really wanted to share about the Holy Spirit, Mary is the one who carries and envelops us in our Christian life. She disposes our souls to the action of the Holy Spirit, and who in a very intimate and delicate way completes in us this action of the Holy Spirit so that God's graces may be completely efficacious. So to have more of the Holy Spirit, you have to have Mary. I mean, you really do. I mean, there's a lot of people who are just very powerful in the, you know, the charismatic renewal in the Holy Spirit. And I actually went to a charismatic, I think I said this last time, a conference one time. And I mean, this man, there were healings. And I went up to him afterward and I said, are you devoted? I don't know how I said it, but, you know, Mary, something like that. And he's like, oh, no, the Mary movement is something different. I'm like, oh, no, you know, you have to have them both because then you'll be even more powerful than you are now. But not that he's powerful, but he has gifts of the Spirit. And those gifts just come into a clearer focus and they become purified because you might have the gift of prophecy or something, but it's going to have some selfishness attached to it. You know, there's going to be something that if you bring Mary into the picture, she's going to purify your gift, okay? You might have the gift, whatever it is. All the gifts aren't extraordinary. Some are just ordinary gifts, like some are leaders, some are administrators. There's like 25 or so mentioned in Scripture that St. Paul mentions. We'll talk about the gifts of the Spirit. It's not just the seven. You know, those are called the seven gifts that we receive in confirmation, but there's the spiritual gifts as well. And it's basically, you know what it is. It's like your career you go into. It's what you're good at. It's some people have a love for the poor. Some people have a love for children. You know, some people have a love for the elderly. Those are gifts. Those are charismatic gifts. I mean, they're not the extraordinary ones. They're the ordinary ones. I don't know if I'm explaining that right, am I? Okay. Anyway, we'll talk more about that as the year goes on. Yeah, she does. She helps, purifies them and makes them more. Yes, yes. Right. Yeah, so you're going to, she keeps the devil away, right? Okay, we'll talk a lot about that as the year goes on. But this is one last thing I just want to, maybe I already read it. Oh, okay. It says, although Mary's presence is hidden in us, this presence is efficacious and real. It is the presence of someone who maternally acts in us, who gives us God's life, and who never ceases to prepare us and make us docile to the motion of the Holy Spirit. So she helps you to be open to receive the gifts he has to give you and to be open, especially to his voice. You know, like I was saying earlier, like that guy, like, he'd hear the Holy Spirit, and I'd be like, how do you hear the Holy Spirit? Well, Mary, like, takes the plugs out of your ears, and she gives you glasses, and some priest said that the Bible story, or scripture verse we had recently at Mass about Jesus puts his fingers in the ears. Well, he's, like, plugging him in, you know, but Mary takes our plugs out, the ones that block us from hearing the Holy Spirit. So it's just a great gift. All right, let's go on. Okay, now this is an extremely beautiful paragraph. I have a lot of favorites, but this one, I love whenever St. Louis de Montfort describes Mary as the Garden of Eden. Like, and I often think of her as, when I close my eyes, I think of the Garden of Eden, or I think of just a beautiful garden, and there's, you know, I'm this little flower down here, and there's all, you know, because when you close your eyes, you know, you're surrounded by all the saints, and, you know, they're not far away, and your loved ones, and you know, the angels, you know, you can close your eyes and be, because the kingdom of God is within you. So Jesus says that. You can close your eyes and unite yourself. And so I always imagine, you know, there's all these big roses and, you know, the great saints in there. And then, but you're a flower in there too, in that garden. But anyway, so I love when he talks about her being the Garden of Eden. And I'm also going to read you something here about how she's the new Eve and Jesus is the new Adam. Okay, maybe you've heard that. Maybe you haven't. But the important thing to know about that is that Adam and Eve is a doctrine of the faith. And we're going to talk about the difference between doctrine and dogma later. But a doctrine means you have to believe it. It's required. So, you know, I know a lot of colleges and universities, you don't have to believe it, you know, whatever, that's a myth. But really, it's simple if you think about it. If you don't have Adam and Eve, you don't have original sin. If you don't have original sin, There's no need for baptism. And there's no need for Jesus to come and die on the cross for us to save us, all right? So it just makes sense that once you pull out Adam and Eve, you basically Christianity collapses upon itself. Now, even scientists are saying today that we came from one set of parents. They're starting to discover that. Now, how? I don't know. What do we wait till we get to heaven? Do we can see all of that? Because my kids are always like, well, how can you have Chinese? And you know, I'm like, I don't know. And yes, I believe in evolution. The body could have evolved, but the soul, you know, anyway, my older son likes to pick fights, which is good because that's how he learns. Well, don't tell. She knows my older son. Okay, where were we? Okay, let's start reading. Or I'll read here, number 6. This is a really beautiful. There's a park over there. They could be at that Weller Park, which is just that way. Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, sure. Oh, man. Do you know where they are? Okay. Yeah, and they just go that way. There's a park right there with swings and everything. No, no problem. You got to find your child. I understand that. Yeah, they were asking me if they could take him outside. I'm sorry, I said yes. Okay. All right, okay, so paragraph 6 says, I say with the saints, the divine Mary, and notice it's always a small d for divine when he uses that word. He just means like when we say, oh, it was divine, you know, we don't mean it's God. We just mean it's great, right? So I say with the saints that the divine Mary is the terrestrial paradise of the new Adam, or he was made flesh by the operation of the Holy Ghost in order to work their incomprehensible marvels. She is the grand and divine world of God, where there are beauties and treasures unspeakable. She is the magnificence of the Most High, where he hid, as in her bosom, his only Son, and in him all that is most excellent and most precious. Oh, what grand and hidden things that mighty God has wrought in this admirable creature, as she herself had to acknowledge, in spite of her profound humility, he that is mighty has done great things for me. The world knows them not, because it is both incapable and unworthy of such knowledge. So again, it's because we're finite, and we can't possibly understand it, as we've said before. So my sister does a Bible study in Indianapolis, and her teacher is so magnificent that she has her own website. It's a Catholic Bible study. And she gave me some stuff here on the Blessed Virgin Mary about the Ark of the Covenant, which we'll get to later in the year, which I can't wait to share with you. But this is on the whole new Adam and the new Eve. I just wanted to read some of this to you because it's so interesting. But this especially, this paragraph here is really important for our Protestant friends to hear, and for all of us as well, because sometimes it's hard to explain Mary, but this just nails it on the head. I just love this sentence right here. It says, Adam and Eve both participated in the fall of man. Jesus and Mary were both active participants in the redemption of humanity. As there are both a masculine and a feminine element to the fall of humanity, there is also a masculine and feminine aspect to the redemption of humanity. Isn't that awesome? Okay, so here's some things. So Adam and Jesus were both without sin. I mean, Adam was created without sin. He was immaculately, he wasn't conceived because he was just created as a man somehow. I mean, you know. But anyway, here's the differences. And it's called the antithesis. So Jesus and Mary are the antithesis. It's like the great reversal of Adam and Eve. So here's just a few things. And maybe I can Xerox this and scan it and send it to you. So Adam ends his physical life in sin. Jesus ends his physical life without sin. Adam falls to the serpent. Jesus conquers the serpent. Adam is the head of the human race. Jesus is the head of the church. Adam introduces sin into the world. Jesus takes away the sin of the world. Adam serves himself at the expense of humanity. Jesus sacrifices himself for humanity. And then this one I got from Christopher West. Adam failed to protect his bride. Jesus gave his life to protect his bride. That's so beautiful. And then Eve and Mary, same way. They both, no sin in their souls to begin with. But then Eve, this is very similar to what I just read about Adam. She ends her life in sin. Mary ends her life without sin. Eve disobeys God. Mary completely obeys God. Eve is the mother of humanity. Mary is the mother of the church and all believers in Christ. Eve was the first sinner. Mary was the first Christian. Eve was self-interested and self-indulgent. Mary was completely altruistic and at the service of God's will before her own. So, just interesting. There's like a little YouTube video out there. If someone sends that to me, I can forward it to everyone that even explains this better and then goes on to talk about her being the Ark of the Covenant. So the similarities between the Ark of the Covenant and Mary are just awesome. You got to wait for that. The video?
Yeah.
I might have it saved. If you email me and say, Ann, look for that video, I'll try to look for it. I think because I save the good stuff. So I think I have it in my True Devotion file. That's really big. Then I'll have to search through and find it when I get a free minute. So it might be a while. But anyway, all right. So again, we got 15 minutes, so we'll see if we can get through. But I am going to finish this section just because I have to get to the same place we were on Tuesday or I'll get all confused. Okay, so the next paragraph. Now, this paragraph contains a very controversial sentence. But as I said, when you come to these kinds of sentences, just come and don't throw the book out the window. Come and let's talk about it. Because everything in here is explainable. You know, it sounds like heresy, but if you come in, we can take a look at it. And remember that down through the centuries, popes and saints have treasured this book, read this book, promoted this book. Okay, I'm going to read 7. The saints said admirable things about this holy city of God. That's another name for Mary, the city of God. And as they themselves avow, they were never more eloquent and more content when they spoke of her. Yet, after all they had said, they cry out that the height of her merits, which she has raised up to the throne of the divinity, cannot be fully seen. The breadth of her charity, which is broader than the earth, is in truth immeasurable. That the length of her power, which she exercises even over God himself, is incomprehensible. And finally, that the depths of her humility and of all her virtues and graces is an abyss which can never be sounded. O height incomprehensible, O breadth unspeakable, O length immeasurable, O abyss impenetrable. So we can only know a tiny bit about her in this life. And it's awesome, the little bit that we know. I can't imagine when we finally get to see her for who she really is. I mean, it's going to be unbelievable. So what about this one little sentence that he threw in there? Let's take a look at that. Question number 4. Okay. In paragraph 7, St. Louis de Montfort makes a somewhat startling claim that Mary has power over God himself. Considering that this book was found to be without error, I always like to remind people of that. What do you think St. Louis de Montfort actually means by this statement? Okay, well, as we said before, all the power that she has or that we have comes from God. Okay? And also, as we said before, God rewards us with gifts. Can you imagine the rewards she got when she died and went to, whether she died or fell asleep, we don't know. But can you imagine when she was given the role of queen of the universe, queen of heaven, queen of the angels? She doesn't just sit there and wear a nice crown. You know, she has power. God has given her and has rewarded her. And in the next week or next meeting, we're going to really focus in on this more. What her powers or her gifts, it's better just to call them gifts. Her power comes from God. He freely shares of his nature, which is something I didn't say before. Grace, if I could ask you to give me a definition of grace, I'd probably get as many different answers as people in this room, and it's kind of hard to put your finger on what is grace. But this is a working definition that I love that I got from Father Gaffney. And grace is God sharing his divine nature with us. Remember, we have our human nature that left by ourselves, we're going to mess things up, right? So we need grace to be able to grow in holiness. So grace is God sharing part of himself with us, something that we don't have naturally, okay? So for example, this is a good analogy, that if, you know, it's not God just giving us something. It's actually him imparting his divine life with us. So like if you had a tree, you know, you could give it water or you could do something, you know, and trim it. But if you could make the tree walk, you would be imparting some of your human nature to the tree. So that's what grace is. And that's just a really good definition, I think, of God actually helps us to become God-like. All right? So Mary, back to Mary, being full of grace, obviously she wasn't God, but she had unbelievable attributes of God, like we will in heaven. Okay, so this power, okay, so what? That explains how she has the power, why she has the power, where she gets the power. She was rewarded with power. But what's this mean over God? Okay, first of all, she never, ever, ever does anything or thinks anything opposed to God's will. Okay, that's the first thing just to know right off the bat. She doesn't have one will over here, and then God has a different will. Now, that being said, as we see in the wedding feast at Cana, she told God to do something, and his will was obviously different. But it wasn't opposed to his will. And I love this. It's because there's this wideness in God's plan. You know, and he's so loving and so merciful that he makes room for our ideas. Isn't that beautiful? That's not opposed to maybe the way he would have done it. So his mother, never being opposed, can suggest things to God. Of course, he knows it all, and he gives her these great ideas. So, you know, it's not, you know, giving her something that is above him. But it's kind of like when you have a king and queen on down here on earth, the king trusts the queen. And if you could go directly to the king, but if you went through the queen with a request, the king might be more likely to listen to the queen than if you had gone as a peasant yourself. So it's just like my husband trusts me with a checkbook. Maybe he shouldn't, but he does. You know, it's that same sort of thing. I don't have to go and ask him every time. You know, he just trusts me. So he trusts Mary. And so this whole idea of him having power over her, I think it's best thought of as like when you're holding an infant. We have some infants in here. You know the power of, yeah. So, you know, when you look and you're holding a baby, I mean, they're so precious that they have a certain power over us. Do you know what I mean? Like that's kind of what it is with God and Mary. And with, I mean, and he loves us this much too. I mean, we're so precious to him that he's moved to grant our requests because he loves us so much. So it's that kind of a power that Mary has over him. It's not some her telling him what to do or anything like that. It's just that he is so moved by her beauty and her virtues, and she just blows him away with her humility and her love and her faith. You know, because she had free will, and she chose to always do. And to God, that is, you know, we can't even imagine the love that he has for her. And so he's moved to, that's what this means. Okay, it's not a power per se over God. I mean, that's crazy. That would be utter heresy to say that Mary had some sort of power that God didn't have or something like that. All right, as we'll see next time, compared to God, she's less than an atom. No, she's nothing. Atom, A-T-O-M, Atom. So I hope that helps. I mean, I have here, but we're not going to have time to read it. But if you look at paragraph 27 later, and we're going to get eventually to paragraph 27. Paragraph 27 says that Jesus obeys his mother still in heaven. Mothers have a certain amount of authority and power over their children. Well, because she's the perfect mother, she's still, like the wedding feast at Cana, she's still, you know, she can still tell him things, and he still obeys her. Now, her will doesn't trump his will, but that's almost, you don't even need to say that, because her will is never opposed to his will, ever. Not in the slightest. Okay? So I hope that helps. If not, you know, just keep praying over it. All right, let's go on. And I love, love, love this paragraph. And I love it more now than I did in the past, because last year, Mary really, every year she teaches me something new. Because, you know, like we're like children, we can't have the solid food until we've had the milk, you know. And so she just gives you a little bit of milk at a time, and then she gives you, you know, cereal, and then she gives you the more. So we can only accept a little bit at a time. And so, but anyway, last year she really taught me about the angels, and it's been such a joy to have this devotion to the angels in my life. And I pray to them constantly, and she's queen of the angels. So this paragraph is about the angels, so I get really kind of giddy when I read about the angels. It says, every day, from one end of the earth to the other, in the highest heights of the heavens and in the profoundest depths of the abysses, everything preaches, everything publishes the Admirable Mary. The nine choirs of angels, men of all ages, sexes, conditions, and religions, the good and the bad, nay, even the devils themselves, willingly or unwillingly, are compelled by the force of truth to call her blessed. St. Bonaventure tells us that all the angels in heaven cry out incessantly to her, Holy, Holy, Holy Mary, Mother of God and Virgin, and that they offer to her millions and millions of times a day the angelical salutation, Ave Maria, which is Hail Mary. Oh, they must be loving today the name of Mary. Prostrating themselves before her and begging of her in her graciousness to honor them with some of her commands. This is so awesome. Even St. Michael, as St. Augustine says, although the prince of the heavenly court is the most zealous in honoring her and causing her to be honored, and is always anxiously awaiting the honor of going at her bidding to render some service to one of her servants. I believe this is true. I really do. I believe that as queen of the angels, that she sends the angels on their little missions. And so I'm always saying, queen of the angels, send all of them, all nine choirs. Like if I go travel somewhere, I'm just like, just surround my vans around the road and I just ask for, you know, go big. I'm not just going to ask for one. I do. And I tell them to surround this building and to surround all of you on your drives here. And I do. And we have to take advantage of that. We have to take advantage because we're in a spiritual warfare, and it's a warfare. And so it's spiritual warfare. So if we're not calling upon the angels to fight for us, you know, we're really missing in a very important part of fighting evil in the world. We have to. And so she's queen. And I love this, that they just anxiously await, you know, they love her so much. And St. Michael, it's really, I just love that this is in here too, because I think if you've had a devotion to St. Michael, he leads you to Mary, you know. He leads you to the queen. And Father Lance Harlow says that St. Michael is a special ally of those devoted to Mary.
He always goes
right before her. They're always together. And so, you know, it's just wonderful to learn these realities. And that's what part of humility is seeing spiritual realities, seeing reality in general, you know. And something I didn't say earlier, but pride is the opposite of all those things I read to you before. So, you know, pride doesn't see you as a child of God. Pride doesn't see you as beautiful. Pride says that these gifts are my gifts, and I'll use them how I want to use them. And pride doesn't see the spiritual realities, you know. And so, all right, let's go on here. Actually, I'm going to skip this one because we're running out of time. Number 9 just says that, you know, there's not a church, Catholic church in the world without some altar with Mary, and talks about different confraternities and associations of Mary and statues. And even in this country, you know, our country is entrusted to the Immaculate Conception. We have Our Lady of Guadalupe, patroness of the Americas, and so that's what that. But let's look at number 5, because the very last sentence here says, of paragraph 9, it's the very last sentence says, nay, the very devils in hell respect her while they fear her. So why is that? Let's look at question number 5. So the demons are bound by truth. So they're liars. But if a priest, like say in an exorcism, commands them to say something, they have to speak the truth. They have to say what their names are or whatever it is or what they're doing. And then I have a beautiful story to read you later in the year about this, how St. Dominic commanded the devil. It's so funny. I just laugh so hard when I read this story. But he commands the devils to say who do they fear the most, and they don't want to. And they're like, oh, can we just whisper it to you in your ear? And he's like, no, say it out loud. So finally they have to say Mary. They fear her the most. And why is that? Because they know scripture. They know Genesis 3:15. And they fear her more than all the angels and saints combined, because she's been given the mission to crush his head. And that's why Our Lady of Fatima says, in the end, my Immaculate Heart will triumph. You know, so if we're not including Mary in our battles, you know, we're really missing it. We're not using all the weapons that God has given us. And she's going to be the one. That's why she needs to be a huge part of the pro-life movement and everything. Actually, I have some prayers of that I forgot to bring. Okay, so they know scripture. They know that she's going to, in the end, crush their head where their pride dwells. You know, that's why it says crush their head. Well, Satan being the top choir, I don't know if that's a first or the ninth, the seraphim, I never know, first. Okay, so the highest choir of angels is a seraphim. They're the most intelligent. You probably know this, but some people don't realize that Lucifer was among the seraphim. And he was so intelligent, and so God showed the plan of salvation history, and he didn't like the fact that a human would be placed, let alone a little meek woman, handmaid of the Lord, would be his queen that he would have to obey. So he didn't like that. So he rebelled, but that's why God uses her, the humble, to shame the proud. So that's why. But they respect her because, as she said, all generations will call me blessed. And that goes for, they understand, they respect her power, but not in a good way, in a way that they don't like. Okay, the one thing I want to mention here that Father Basil wanted me to say is that when I say things like, she has more power than all the angels and the saints combined, which she does, and that the devil is more fearful of one of her prayers than all the angels and saints combined. Father Basil said, be sure you say that. I'm not trying to say that we shouldn't pray to the angels and the saints. Okay, yes, she is. But in God's mysterious way, he rewards the saints. You know, so I might be praying to Mary for something, and this has happened to me many times, and I'm praying to Mary, and then I try to do this on a regular basis. I always tell my kids who the saint of the day is on the drive to school every morning, because I tell them, pray to, well, the name of Mary today, you know, or the saint, whoever, because I do believe that God has given, because of his goodness, the saints certain special intercessory power on their feast days. And so, you know, I remember one time I could not get my baby to go to sleep, and I was praying, begging Mary, and then I remembered it was, well, I think it was St. Stephen or whatever it was, and I'm like, oh, St. Stephen, and boom, that boy stopped crying. And so you see, Mary is, yes, more powerful, but God just, we're all a big family, and he wants us to use each other, and he wants us to pray to the angels and the saints. Now, normally when I pray novenas to the saints, love novenas, I'll usually say through the Immaculate Heart of Mary, just like to get it all in there, you know, just to like not leave any power out that I can. But I just want to throw that in. You know that I never mean to say that we should only go to Mary and never pray to the angels and saints. He wanted me to make sure I mentioned that. Okay, so we're at the end here. This part goes kind of fast. Paragraphs 10, 11, and 12 are the conclusions of this section. So that's why he begins 10, 11, and 12 with after that. After that, meaning after all we just read, here's his conclusions. Okay, he laments that knowing all of this, which most people don't know, but he knows it, and he laments that people don't love her more and that she isn't more honored. So notice when we read number 10 here that he does not use the word adore. Okay, we do not worship Mary. We adore God alone, okay? Now, he does use the word praise, but he doesn't mean it in a way that we're, you know, that praise that's due to God alone. He means it like, you know, we praise each other, you know, all the time. Good job, you know, that kind of like just a pleasing kind of encouragement. Okay, after that, number 10, we must cry out with the saints of Mary. There is never enough. We have not yet praised, exalted, honored, loved, and served Mary as we ought. She deserves still even more praise, still more respect, still more love, and still more service. Number 11. After that, we must say with the Holy Ghost, all the glory of the King's daughter is within. Remember, when you see the word within, it means, you know, hidden from us. The outward glory, which heaven and earth rival each other in laying at her feet, I love that image, is as nothing compared with that which she receives from her Creator and which is not known by creatures who in their littleness are unable to penetrate the secret of the secrets of the King. So as St. Faustina said, God lavishes his love and graces upon a humble soul. Can you imagine the joy she receives from God, just what God showers her with? So we can't understand that in this life is what he's saying. Number 12, after that we must cry out with the apostle, eye is not seen, nor ear heard, nor man's heart comprehended the beauties, the grandeurs, the excellences of Mary, the miracle of the miracles of grace, nature, and glory. If you wish to comprehend the mother, says a saint, comprehend the son, for she is the worthy mother of God. Here let every tongue be mute, meaning we can't explain it, even if we tried. Only in the next life will we understand. But I love that he says, if you wish to understand the Mother, understand the Son. Basically what he's saying is, when you look at Jesus, you can see Mary, because she is the moon that reflects the light of the sun. And Father Al Lauer says, Presentation Ministries, a lot of you have heard of him, love his show at 10 o'clock on Sacred Heart Radio for 15 minutes. It is a shot in the arm. You turn on Sacred Heart Radio every day at 10, and it's just, wow, he packs it in there. But he said, he's in heaven, of course, so it's a tape show. I pray to him every day, for he's so awesome. But he said that you need Jesus to have true devotion to Mary, that Jesus actually leads us to his Mother. And even though we always hear that Mary leads us to Jesus, it actually works both ways, and that the closer you get to Jesus, he'll eventually lead you to true devotion to Mary, and vice, and then she leads you closer to him, and then it's like an upward spiral of growing closer to them. Okay, let's just answer this last question here. I'm going to just read this. What does it mean that Mary is the miracle of the miracles of grace, nature, and glory? Now, when I first year I did this, I'm like, that would be a good question to ask. Well, I don't know what the answer is, you know. And that happened quite a bit in the first year I did this. I'm like, that sounds like a good question, but I have no idea what the answer is. So, you know, Mary, you got to help me out here. And so, sure enough, it was in the middle of the night, which is often when she tells me things. Like this morning, she told me to, and I wasn't, my alarm hadn't even gone off, and she told me to get up and print some extra copies. So I got up. But she really did. But she does. You hear her when you're not thinking your own thoughts a lot of times. And so in the middle of the night, when you get thoughts popping into your head, you got to recognize that those are a lot of times from your angel. And Father Basil said that most of our thoughts are from the angels. And that's something I didn't know. I'm always saying, Mary told me this, Mary told me that. And yeah, Mary, but she sends the angels to honor them. She usually sends your guardian angel to tell you something. So isn't that great to know? That's why it's nice to have a priest. And the saints, right. So it's not often that she comes herself, but she did talk to my daughter. So I have to tell Father Basil once in a while. She does, but no, but he said that in his notes. He says it's kind of rare to have Mary, to hear her voice or something. But anyway, what I say is it doesn't matter who you say it is. Holy Spirit, it was Mary, it was my angel, it was God, it was Jesus, you know, because it's just like one big family, and they all work together, you know, so you're not like hurting one's feelings by not acknowledging. So, you know, when I say Mary says this, Mary says that, to me, you know, I understand now that it's usually my guardian angel who's saying it. And I told you the story about my daughter. She's like, well, you hear Mary all the time. I'm like, no, not her voice, not her audible voice. If you weren't here last time, my daughter audibly heard the Blessed Mother's voice, but you have to catch me later for the whole story. Okay, we're almost done. She gave me this answer, which is really quite obvious when I read you the answer. So, first thing I want to say is, if you just write grace, nature, and glory down, St. Louis de Montfort, usually when he's talking about grace, he's referring to the soul, okay? And when he talks about nature, he's referring to the body. And when he talks about glory, he's usually referring to after your death, after the death of a Christian, you know, someone on their way to heaven, okay? So first of all, because he often differentiates between the three, okay? So this is the first time he does it. All right, so how is she a miracle of grace? So she's a miracle of grace in her Immaculate Conception. Because if we're looking at how things are now, not how things were at Adam and Eve's time, that's a miracle of grace, of her soul. So grace has to do with your soul, and that is a miracle of grace is in her Immaculate Conception. She shared the divine nature fully. Okay? Nature. She's a miracle of nature in two ways. Her virginal birth, obviously, pretty miraculous, and her that she did not suffer sickness, disease, or death, or decay, which we all will. Okay, that's the, and no childbirth pains. That's a good one. Yes, she did not suffer, because in Genesis it says that that was part of the punishment for Eve's sin is pain in childbirth. Thanks, Eve. Oh man, but you know, Yes, thank you. I'm going to write that down. That's another one. So her perpetual virginity, her, anyway, she did not suffer from disease or death or old age. And the mystics say, and you don't have to believe this or not, but it's kind of cool that she didn't age past 33. and that she lived to be about 70, so she lived about 30 or 40 years after Jesus died, to mother the infant church. So she mothered the infant Jesus, she mothered the infant church, is why she was left for another couple, 30 years or so. And I just heard someone say that when we get our glorified bodies, we'll all be 33. That's great. I don't know. We'll see. Okay, so how is she a miracle of glory? Two ways. Again, this is after death, so after we die. So she was assumed body and soul into heaven, okay? So that doesn't happen to us, obviously, and our bodies don't go up till the end. And then her coronation is a miracle because none of us are going to be crowned queen, but we will be crowned. But her coronation is unique. So that's the answer. So really, you know, basic stuff, but it's just the way it's worded there. It sounds like, ooh, this is going to be, you know, mysterious or something. All right, so let's end with this last paragraph here, and then we'll be done. I apologize for going late, but we had a little confusion getting started today. This is great, though, to have this room and all these empty seats. Okay, 13. It is with particular joy that my heart has dictated what I have just written, in order to show that the Divine Mary has been up to this time unknown, and that this is one of the reasons that Jesus Christ is not known as he ought to be. If then, as is certain, the knowledge and kingdom of Jesus Christ are to come into the world, they will be but a necessary consequence of the knowledge and the kingdom of the Most Holy Virgin Mary, who brought him into the world for the first time and will make his second advent full of splendor. So her kingdom is his kingdom. She doesn't have a kingdom of her own or anything like that, you know, so don't let that throw you off. But this is very similar to the first paragraph that we read, remember? It kind of finishes the first paragraph. And these 13 paragraphs are really a summary of the whole book. You know, now we're going to, like, the rest of the book is kind of like going deeper into all these ideas. But so Jesus came the first time through her. He doesn't change the way he does things. Jesus comes into the world through her fully. And we don't know how, but kind of have an idea maybe that he's going to come. His second coming will be through her. Now, why we have a little bit of an idea because Mary said at Fatima, which is an approved apparition of the church, that in the end, my Immaculate Heart will triumph. So it's going to be, and maybe it's that Jesus will come spiritually first in our hearts before he comes physically. I don't know. But Mary will have something to do with the second coming, which is very exciting. So after all this, Father Gaffney says that our response to the greatness and the beauty of Mary is total consecration. So that's our response to this, and that's what we're going to talk about the rest of the year, what that is and how we do it. It's quite simple. And so I will see you next time. Let's end, though, with a prayer. I always like to just, this year, we'll just, everybody for a moment, just think of your intentions, and let's just bring them to Mary's heart. And by the way, when I do send a lot of prayer requests, and I know that that can get overwhelming, but you are prayerful people, and people know I have this large group of prayerful people. What I do when I get a prayer request is I immediately put that person in Mary's heart. I don't write the name down, you know, and I don't, sometimes then I forget, but that's, you know, just stop and say a quick Hail Mary. I mean, I'm not trying to tell you what to do, but I know it can get overwhelming to get all these prayer requests all the time, but, you know, that's what we're here for. We're here to pray for one another. And so I hope you don't mind that I'm going to be sending you prayer requests from time to time. But, you know, just putting that person in Mary's heart and saying a quick Hail Mary is amazing, you know, for that person. So let's just bring our requests to Mary right now. And we do this in a spirit of thanksgiving to Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit for giving her to us to bring us closer to them. And I'm going to end with a memorare, and we just give Mary all of our personal intentions. Remember, O most gracious Virgin Mary, never was it known that anyone who fled to thy protection, implored thy help, or sought thy intercession, was left unaided. Inspired by this confidence, I fly unto thee, O Virgin is my mother. To thee I come, before thee I stand, sinful and sorrowful. O Mother of the Word incarnate, despise not my petitions, but in thy mercy hear and answer me. Amen. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, amen. Thank you.